my homage to Brian. The Cosmic Vinyl. One of my favorite openings. That's not a title opening, but hey, Sunday morning, I'm wearing my Sunday comfy pants, so live with it, suck it up. Okay, this is recent finds, new and used, new releases. It's October 2019, and there's a special featurette at the end, commencing with a new record, a new solo album by a woman who used to be in a band that I really like, and I'm gonna do a little feature on those albums. But a little warning, this is my second time doing this video because I got, excuse the expression, cock-blocked for a song, but you'll know later on, it's at the tail end, and I think I've remedied the situation. So if you're up to it and you're up for the challenge, not even a challenge, if you just want to be entertained, or maybe you won't be entertained, but you want to hear something completely different, it's at the end. Anyway, yesterday I went to the Clockout Lounge, which is a club literally like a half a mile from my house. And they have music venue, they have comedy, they have, you know, drag nights, they have rock and roll, they have punk shows, they have karaoke. Cool place, and they have a pizza vendor, deep dish pizza vendor too, but several times a year they have a record swap there. Not the typical official traders, mostly individuals who have big crates of records that want to sell, trade, and I went and I'm going to show you first the used things I picked up. First, commencing with this, because this is a mono Motown, Tamla Motown copy of the Supremes in pristine situation in supreme man Mazzy in perfect shit, it's perfect condition. Perfect condition. Anyway, you don't usually, all the soul stuff, especially this stuff from the 60s, it's usually really trash, really well played, you know, burnt weenie sandwich in a way of the vinyl, crispy crawlers. Perfect vinyl, and has a pristine Tamla Motown inner sleeve. This is a great record. But anyway, that's what I'm gonna be playing. Actually, I'm not gonna play this. Stand by. It's too uppity, too vocally. So I think what I'm gonna do is, in my new releases, which I showcased briefly on my test live video, I'm going to play this in the background. This is a Blue Note 80, Herbie Hancock, Inventions and Dimensions, with Herbie Hancock on piano, the great Paul Chambers on bass, Willie Bobo on drums and timbales, Azvala Chihuahua Martinez on congas and bongos. The recording of the percussion and bass on this is just stunning. So I'm going to have this play in the background, because you heard it. These Blue Notes are all analog, mastered by Kevin Gray. So, you know, it's a good little background thing to listen to. Jazzy. Mazzy jazzy. Jazzy mazzy. Okay, things I picked up. More jazzy. I don't even know this album, but whenever I see an Ornette Coleman record in decent condition, pristine, I don't have it at a reasonable price, I pick it up. This is a probably early 80s fantasy issue of this record, but something else. Ornette Coleman, not to be confused with something else, the great jazz album with Miles Davis and Jones, and you know that one. Anyway. Wailers, we all know this record. I sold a lot of my reggae Wailers albums during the 90s purge, so I've been getting them back. This is one of the few I didn't have. I don't see it in good condition a lot. I mean, although it's out there, I didn't want to reissue this particular one, so I found a nice island pressing. The only time I saw the Wailers was in Oakland at the Paramount Theater, 75, 76, 77-ish in that period. Loved it. Jethro Tull. This was one of the few of the early albums I don't have, no longer have, of Jethro Tull. More bluesy than they're kind of flouty. I mean, flouty, obviously, fluty, flouty, prog stuff. But album, decent price. The Dillards, Doug Dillard and his brother Rodney. Dillard stuff's really country with a little kind of modern. I don't want to say modern. This is like 1970s, 72 in that era. Edge. Doug Dillard, you may know because if you're a Gene Clark fan, after Gene left the Byrds and went solo on A&M Records, made a series of several albums with Doug Dillard called Dillard and Clark. If you're a Gene Clark fan, you like more the country side of that, great stuff. This is, I know this album well, Elektra Records. I just haven't had it in years. But anyway, on Elektra Records, the Dillards, Herb Pedersen plays some banjo and guitar on it. Buddy Emmons plays a great pedal steel. So if you know those names, if you know, pre-Graham Parsons, if you like all that stuff, and post-Bird, Sweetheart of the Rodeo. You know, can't have too much Funkadelic. Again, two albums that I had back in the day. My friend from Polygram back in the day used to give me these, and again, they went with the Purge. So I'm trying to find original copies, and I don't find them a lot in good shape, if at all. I just see, mostly I see the reissues. So I was happy to pick these up. And I think, am I wrong on this? You might know out there. I think the illustrator, the artist who did these covers, just recently passed away. But what a great look and a great kind of campaign for George Clinton and Funkadelic. Love this stuff. And then lastly for the new ones, I said several times about Sam Phillips, not to be confused with Sun Session, Sam Phillips, the male producer long gone. She was a Christian artist until this album came out in around 1988. And I saw a showcase at Slim's in San Francisco at Virgin Records. This is her Virgin Records debut. She was married at the time, and for the next, I don't know, 15 years, maybe a little longer, maybe 20 years, her records were produced by her then-husband, T-Bone Burnett. They have a great pop, Beatly sound, really good jingly, jangly guitars on some of the stuff. Gorgeous melodies, good lyrics. She's an amazing artist, and this is during the CD heyday, so I've had this record. I love it. It's her first one on Virgin, and especially What Do I Do? Great, great string arrangement. It's really based on the strings. It's almost all about the strings, kind of like Eleanor Rigby is about strings, and all the strings in that wonderful song by Pete Townsend and Ronnie Lane, Streets of the City. You know those like staccato stringing things? I love that stuff. I have all her albums on CD, a lot of them on vinyl, but again, a lot of her records came out during the vinyl, no-dos vinyl days of the 90s and 2000s. Although Martinis and Bikinis was reissued for a short time. That's an album that you all should get. If you have to get one album, Martinis and Bikinis. And I just saw it, I just pre-ordered, I think it's Fan Dance, an album she did, self-produced. She's been doing some really good kind of crunchy self-produced albums. Unless if she didn't self-produce it, maybe T-Bone still produced that one. And it's gonna be, what's that label, Groove something that you vote every month for a record, and it just won Fan Dance. So I pre-ordered, it's coming out early next year. Fan Dances by Sam Phillips. She plays occasionally at the Largo in LA, so if you get a chance to see her, there's a video out, a live video film of her at the Largo. Great stuff. I think actually she did the score for the TV show The Gilmore Girls, but I never saw that. So, but her stuff's very poppy, but with a great, you know, that T-Bone crunchy sound, even her self-produced records. I'm a huge fan of her, so anything Sam Phillips does, Mazzy's there. So there. Okay, in the new release sections, that was, you see Herbie Hancock, the other Blue Note that I got, there was another one Inside Out, which I already had. I think it's Outside Inside, or I'm blanking out who it is now. But Jutta Hip, a German pianist, came around in the late 50s, this was recorded in 1957. It's got Zoot Sims, and I didn't realize who was on it, and I just put it on, and at first I thought it was, it sounded almost exactly like Stan Getz. It's got that kind of throaty, kind of sexy saxophone sound. And then someone pointed out to me that Zoot and Stan Getz sort of came up together and had played together, so there's a very similar sounding here on that album. Also, Ahmed Abdul-Malik and Ed Thigpen are on this as well. Again, she came from Germany. She got a lot of push in the club scene in New York in the late 50s, but cool record with another great Reed Miles cover. So that's a great one. A record I pre-ordered literally 3 months ago because of one song. Gabby Moreno and Van Dyke Parks, a Latina Latin singer. She's amazing, amazing sounding. Van Dyke Parks, you might know, you should know if you don't know him. Orchestration, arranger, composer, worked with the Beach Boys, Brian Wilson a lot in the 60s, little post Pet Sounds period, wild stuff, wild composer. A bunch of soul albums of his that are offbeat, but really cool. He's part of that whole Warner Brothers clique with Ry Cooder, Randy Newman, and everything in the 60s, and worked on a lot of those records, playing on them and working on them. 10 years ago or so, he did a great album. He composed all the arrangements or orchestration for Joanna Newsom, album called Is, or YS, I don't know how you pronounce it, but one of my favorite records, little offbeat, unusual arrangements in his orchestration. Most of this is in Spanish, not all of it, but the opening cut is what sold me. It's a song called Across the Borderline, not to be confused with Borderline by Madonna, but a song co-written by Jim Dickinson and Ry Cooder and someone else, I forgot, for the motion picture The Border that came out in the late 80s with Jack Nicholson and Harvey Keitel about, so it's a very topical subject these days. And this version of it, the original version on the soundtrack, I think Freddie Fender did the vocal, and then some years later in the 90s, Willie Nelson did a cover on it. Great, great song, but gorgeous. It features Gabby as the main vocalist, the vocalist, and double, triple-ing her vocals on some of the harmonies, as well as Jackson Brown comes in for a verse. Ry Cooder does a great two-bar or two-section slide guitar on this. But gorgeous record. And I'm excited to hear it all. I've only heard one side so far. But on Nonsuch Records, but that song, Border, which I'll link below, hopefully. Now, Sturge, the old Sturge Meister. Sturge, I was going to say Sturge Nelson. That sounds like Nelson Wilbury. But Sturgis, Sturge Simpson, what his name was, fuck his name. Sturgill Simpson, his fourth solo album as far as I know. Doesn't that look like, I wish I should have brought it up here. Crown of Creation, Jefferson Airplane has the Atom Bomb, as does a Count Basie record, you know? So, but there's a long form video. I'm not going to say anything about this really, because just go to John with no H. On Digital Gramophone makes no sense. He did a whole thing on this and Sturge, and the Sturge, and he talks about the Sturge. So I'll do a link to his channel as well for Sturgill Simpson. But his new album, the guy started out country. In fact, because of John, I just found the other day at my local his first solo album. It's more country. Because I have a second and third. And he just changes it up every album. He does country, then he gets into sort of a psychedelic country, then he gets into a funk, Stax, Volts, soulful country, then he gets into ZZ Top, not even country. But again, John knows more than I do because he is the Digital Gramophone. And with the digital part of Gramophone, he can probably just googly-moogly it, and he knows it. But again, you know, being a Southern boy, he just knows that because that kind of stuff comes naturally in the South, I think. So Sturge, excited about this one. His last two albums were amongst my favorites of those years. Now into my... a very new album that just came out in the last week. I love it. It's an artist that a lot of people, they have a cult following. This is her first solo album. It's Kim Gordon. Kim Gordon was a bass player and some guitar work, a member of the Sonic Youth. Sonic Youth and Kim Gordon obviously were part of that No Wave movement of New York, early to mid 80s. I saw them once in like mid 80s in San Francisco at the Stone Club on Broadway. That's now again a strip club, dinner theater strip club, all you can eat. I saw them again about 10 years ago at the Fillmore, and in between that, I saw them open for Neil Young. But I'll talk a little more about Sonic Youth now that I can not get cock blocked, because this is the second time I've made this video. I got blocked for playing some tunes from this Kim Gordon record. I think people should hear it. I get it, but you know, I'm showcasing the music, so there'll be a link below. There's a song on here that got me hooked on this called Airbnb. Maybe they'll buy it for her and she'll make some money, you know, if she wants to license and commercialize. Nothing wrong with that, in my opinion. Artist needs to make friggin' money, so whatever. But Kim Gordon, solo album. They came also, it's kind of the no noise or the noise movement, the industrial stuff, more commercial than, say, Tootie Van Cossey in Throbbing Gristle, but challenging for some people. So this is a Maslov, a highly recommended album. I've listened to it twice now. I love it. Ain't for everybody. Noise, ethereal, post-punk, some beat poetry, kind of low-key stuff as well. There'll be a link below to one of the songs, but search out more. I love Kim Gordon, and I'm looking forward to really kind of getting more into that album. I'll showcase this. This is her autobiography. Basically, the band split up about 6-7 years ago. Kim left the band, so Sonic Youth is no more, at least for the time being. I think Thurston Moore has a new album out too, which I haven't heard. And there's Ronaldo, and I forgot who else. This is her autobiography. Came out 3-4 years ago, I think. Really good book. And what's great, I'm excited about this. I found this in Powell's Books in a great, giant, humongous bookstore in Portland, Oregon. And this is a Girl in the Band. It's called, signed by the author and specially bound, 200 copies, one for 200 are for sale. And this is number 7, signed by Kim Gordon. So how cool is that, right? Good book, too. She's now relocated to LA. Some people say that mellowed her out. However, when you hear this album, I don't think it's mellowed her out at all. But I highly recommend it. So, what I did before, again, this is the second time I've done this video, so I'm gonna do sort of a mini showcase. I hate that when you just throw the records on the floor, Mazzy. What I did the first round, I played a bunch of tunes from this and I got blocked. Okay, they're right, I get it. I don't take it personally because I represent artists and so I understand. But to me, when you're showcasing the work and trying to sell it, but I guess the algorithms and the bots can't, you know, who knows? Maybe I'm thinking I'm trying to monetize something. But anyway, that's a whole other discussion. So I'm gonna put on music that I think is appropriate. It's not Kim Gordon, and I'm gonna show my Sonic Youth record collection, showcase it. Again, I don't have all their records, but they're a band that I keep meaning to get everything on vinyl. And I love them. Some of their stuff's challenging out there, but when you're in the mood, you're in the mood. But again, I saw them, also what I was gonna say is I saw them, they did a tour, I think in the 90s, maybe late 90s, where they toured with Neil Young and they opened for his entire tour. And I kept hearing rumblings about that. I saw it at the Cow Palace in San Francisco, actually in Daly City, out right outside of San Francisco, where the Beatles played the first two times when they came to the Bay Area. And Sonic Youth opened up, and the typical audience of Neil Young, who wanted Harvest and all that stuff, just doesn't get Sonic Youth. Some people were booing, walking out to the lobby for the break until Neil came on back after the intermission. But when you think of Neil, he loves that kind of stuff. He is, aside from the country, folky stuff, you know that adventurous side of Neil Young, Arc Weld, the stuff with you know, loud guitar feedback, Lanois with Daniel Lanois, which is one of my favorite albums, And if I ever can find an album on that, I think it only came out in Germany in vinyl. I love La Noise, that Daniel Lanois encouraged Neil to do some sounds with. So I should show that at some point, but you should listen to it. La Noise, Not For Everybody Again, or then Psychedelic Pill, which is what, 10 years ago, whenever that was. That's a whole other topic, Neil Young. But it brings me to him trying to promote Sonic Youth, and his audience kind of gave them the cold shoulder. So anyway, I tried this video once. I'm just gonna go through and showcase, not really say much about my Sonic Youth records. But while I do that, I'm gonna put on some, since I can't play any music by Kim Gordon, I'm gonna put on something that I think is appropriate in the similar vein. So stand by. Okay, while we play Sonic Youth, I'm gonna put the Chipmunks Sing the Beatles in the background. Dave Seville, a piano player. Alvin Simon Theodore with Dave Seville. What the fuck does this have to do with Sonic Youth and Kim Gordon? I wanted something completely opposite. Since I can't play Kim Gordon music, I'm playing Alvin Simon and Theodore and Dave Seville singing the Beatles. Sonic Youth, Sister. Sonic Youth got their name from Fred Sonic Smith from MC5 and Big Youth, the reggae artist. Maybe their most accessible, my favorite of theirs, on Geffen, Goo. On Geffen, Goo. Goo on Geffen. Chicone Youth, an offshoot project with three of the members plus some other people. They had to get permission. They actually sent the Xerox of this cover to Warner Brothers where Chicone's sister worked. And if you know who Chicone is, that's the official or the real last name of Madonna. So this is a picture of Madonna from the Xerox. And Madonna loved it because she worked in the, you know, East Village and going to the clubs, dance to the clubs, played in the dance club. So actually she got it. And so they put a picture on the cover of this album. Kind of a cool offbeat project. The Whitey album. Daydream Nation, Sonic Youth, again. This is 2007. I don't know if the record actually came out then. This is just a reissue of the vinyl, so this came out earlier. I guess. I don't remember. I'm sorry. I'm failing my audience here. As He Loves You. Okay, and lastly, not their last album, but it's the last vinyl album I have, Sonic Youth. This is a personal favorite of mine as well. This came out 2004. Great artwork. I wish the vinyl was available for everybody. I think it's really hard to get now, unless they reissued it, but I haven't really kept up. But there you go, Sonic Youth, a band I love of I don't want to say grungy, because they're not grungy, but post-punk, industrial, noise. Cool artists. I love when they just, you know, play guitars with strings and different tunings and different arrangements. And again, not for the faint of heart sometime, but they can be melodic as well. That kind of artsy East Village, South of Market, you know, pick your city, pick your artsy hipster neighborhood before it's sold out. But Kim Gordon, highly recommended for those of you who like to take chances. In fact, I get a lot of, I bought several albums by Dave of localography, what's his name? Dave in Carolinas. He turned me onto that Diagonal Spanish record. But I think, Dave, I think if you're listening, if you're watching this, or somebody tell Dave, I called him out here. Local bandography, right? I think you'll like this this album by Kim Gordon, so I think you should get this. I love to spend everybody else's money. And remember, Dave, don't eat seven-day-old pork.
One, two, three,
four. Take care, VC. Mazzy loves you.